Well, I had to bring my mirror back out to the car. I thought I was going to be talking to myself today, so I had to have something to look at. But hey, we got quite a crowd here today. And glad to see the Ann Arbor Church shut down. And we got some people from there again, old friends, and some of our friends from Flint as well. Glad to see you folks. Glad to see you folks. Well, today we're at the precipice of the Feast of Tabernacles. So the title that I have for you today is this: Booths, Rejoicing, and Other Neat Feast Stuff. So if you can put that all on your page. As an alternate title, you could use this: Fear God, Your Internal Life Depends on It. So take your pick. Take your pick of titles, that is. Turn to Leviticus 23 and verse 34. Leviticus 23 and verse 34. All of us in God's church look upon the Feast of Tabernacles as a very special time of the year. It is an exhilarating climax, enabling us to get through many spiritually rough spots. Very few of us take the feast for granted. It's a specially special time. In the feast, spiritual and physical fulfillment combine, and we anticipate it with a hopeful expectation of joy exceeding that of any other time of the year, usually for most of us at least. Yet hardly anybody around the world, around us, even those who profess that the Bible is the instruction book for their religion, has even heard of it, let alone know anything about it. Interestingly, with all the cash you have in your pocket ready to go to the feast, interestingly, rejoice appears for the first time in scriptures within the instructions for the Feast of Tabernacles. Quite a coincidence, huh? I think God probably saw that coming. Leviticus 23 and verse 34. Hopefully you're all there by now. Speak to the children of Israel, saying, in the fifth day of the seventh month shall be the Feast of Tabernacles, for one day to the Lord. Is that what your book says? Is that what your book says? Not mine either. Some people kind of keep it that way, but that's not what the book says. Speak to the children of Israel, saying, the 15th day of the seventh month shall be the Feast of Tabernacles for 7 days to the Lord, not just one. All of these days have spiritual significance, every single one of them, or God would not have put them in the scriptures this way. Verse 37, these are the feasts of the Lord which you shall proclaim to be holy convocations. If you don't know what the word convocations means, it's meetings. Simply, it's a more complicated word for meetings. These are feasts of the Lord which you shall proclaim to be holy meetings. That is the focus of what's being said here. To offer an offering made by fire to the Lord. Skipping to verse 40 to stay in the context. And you shall take for yourselves on the first day the fruit of beautiful trees, branches of palm trees, the boughs of leafy trees and willows of the brook, and you shall rejoice before the Lord your God for how many days? 7. And it's a physical rejoicing for 7 days, and it is also a spiritual rejoicing. You shall keep the feast to the Lord for 7 days of the year. It shall be a statute forever in your generations. You shall celebrate it in the seventh month, and shall dwell in booths for 7 days. All who are native Israelites shall dwell in booths, that your generations may know that I made the children of Israel to dwell in booths when I brought them out of the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God, who's proclaimed all this stuff to you and gave us instructions on what we're supposed to do during this feast. Turn to Isaiah 5 and verse 11. Turn to Isaiah 5 and verse 11. And while you're turning there, I'm just going to highlight Deuteronomy 16 and verse 15. Deuteronomy 16, verse 15, uses a stronger phrase in relation to rejoicing at the feast. It says this, so that you shall, and the shall is in the King James, not in the New King James, so that you shall surely rejoice. And shall adds a command from God. You shall, not maybe. You're not supposed to think about having a good time and celebrating the feast. You shall rejoice. It is a command. The wording is so, in the New King, the King James Version is the closest to the original, Ben Asher Masoretic text. That is the closest rendition, translation of the Bible to the original Ben Asher Masoretic text. So the shall does belong in there. The wording is so strong that it might mislead us into thinking that it is to be one great big blast at the feast. I've had more than my share of fun at every single feast I've ever gone to. I mean physical fun as well as spiritual fun. Make no mistake, God desires us to rejoice, but he wants us to rejoice with purpose. When we are out rejoicing with all that cash that we're spending and having a good time, we should be doing it with a spiritual purpose. And I'm sure you can think of many things that could apply to that purpose. Like every time you spend something on something, it's a perfect time to say, Almighty God, I thank you with all of my heart for this, for all the what you've given me to help me financially and spiritually. And I particularly enjoy buying these things during this time of year because you have so blessed me. Those kind of things should be a part of our feast as we're going about the feast. If we were not rejoicing with his purpose in mind, we are nearly exciting our senses. If we are not rejoicing with his purpose in mind, we are merely exciting our physical senses, not doing anything spiritual. Isaiah 5, verses 11 and 12 give us a vivid picture of a wrong kind of rejoicing. It's not the only kind, wrong kind of rejoicing, but it's the example that God's giving us in the scripture. Isaiah 5 and verse 11. Woe to those who rise early in the morning that they may follow intoxicating drink, who continue until night till wine inflames them, the harp and the strings, all kinds of beautiful, exciting music. The harp and the strings, the tambourines and the flute, and wine are in their feasts, but they do not regard the work of the Lord nor consider the operation of his hands. They do all these things, and there's not a thing wrong with doing any of these things so long as you don't do them to excess. In this context, feast does not necessarily imply a holy day. However, it shows that we can have good things of life as blessings from God, too, during the feast and at other times of the year as well. Yet, if you misuse them by removing God from his purpose and their proper enjoyment, we're doing nothing spiritual. It has absolutely nothing to do spiritual. And absolutely, the things that we do at the feast, spending that tithe money that God gave us for that purpose, everything we do, we should try to look for reasons to have a spiritual overtone to what we're doing and a thank you to God, you know, as appropriate. Leviticus 23 places rejoicing in the context with and subordinate to dwelling in booths. We keep the feast not merely to rejoice, but also because the Lord made the Israelites to live in booths when he brought them out of Egypt. The booths serve as a focal point to remind the Israelites of something that God did so they could rejoice with understanding. Thus, the Bible calls this festival the Feast of Booths, besides the Feast of Tabernacles. The serious purpose of the feast is further illustrated in Numbers 29, where God lists the sacrifices he commanded to be offered to him at each festival, not just the Feast of Tabernacles, but at each festival. He required the Israel. This is really an interesting figure. Took a little work to put this together. God required the Israelites to sacrifice 189 animals at the Feast of Tabernacles alone. 189 animals, more than at all of the other holy days combined. Is the Feast of Tabernacles special? Oh, yeah. Remember the sacrifice is, remember that a sacrifice is free, is a freely given offering and represents the giving of the self. So says Romans 12, verses 1 and 2. So God seems to expect more sacrifice from his people at the Feast of Tabernacles than at any other time of the year. The feast is more than a vacation. The feast should be more than a vacation, more than just a physical good time. The feast carries overtones of a vacation, no question about that. God wants us to leave behind our normal residence and activities and travel to the place where he sets his name. But it has a far higher and greater purpose than a mere vacation. A mere vacation from duty and responsibilities that we have at home. The feast is a break from one's customary routine. But freedom from duty and responsibility, it definitely is not a break from that. In Jesus' day, many leading Jews observed the festival in a way that God never intended. In Mark 7, verses 6 through 9, Jesus accused the Pharisees of rejecting the commandments of God to keep their own traditions. They had not stopped observing such things as the Feast of Tabernacles. Their problem was in a different area. Paul shows in Romans 10, verses 1 through 3, that the Jews' zeal for God was not according to biblical knowledge. They were guilty of a gross misinterpretation of the scriptures. Their worship was merely outward. It was merely a physical blast. And in some cases for the Jews, many of the things they did were not written in God's law at all. They were written in their oral Torah, which has nothing to do with God's word whatsoever. To this day, many Jews observe the rituals and customs as customary necessities, obscuring God's intended purpose. It is a warning to us because we too can turn the feast into little more than a ceremonial observance. We just like keeping the Sabbath and having your mind on a million other things. Are you really keeping the Sabbath when you do that? Not really. Are you really keeping the feast when God is involved in almost nothing that you do? It's a seven-day feast. If God is not in your mind and involved in each of those days, you're just exciting your senses. It has nothing to do with the spiritual intent that God has for the feast. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. While in our hearts we seek our own dominant position and advancement, we can say, a day in his courts, that would be the Lord's courts, is better than 1,000. A day in the Lord's courts is better than 1,000. Yet spend time with him only when commanded. We can say the words. We can go through the ritual of saying the words, and that can be just a ritual. Yet spend time with him only when commanded. What kind of a close and loving relationship is that? It isn't. Flat out isn't. How would you like to marry someone who said, oh, by the way, would you like to marry me? Yeah, no. Turn to Mark 4 and verse 19. Mark 4 and verse 19. From the Pharisees' example, we learn that ritualizing an event trivializes it. It deceives us into believing that we are okay just because we carried out the duties despite what is in our hearts. We need to view the feast as an opportunity to grow closer to God and fellow Christians as well. As we immerse ourselves in 8 days, counting the eighth day as well in this whole feast period, counting the 8th day as well, as we immerse ourselves in 8 days of intensive learning and fellowship. Otherwise, it is just an exercise, a mere ritual, which means nothing to God. In fact, it probably even upsets God for misusing the feast that he has commanded us to take. Mark 4, verses 18 through 19 brings another principle to bear on the proper observance of the feast. Verse 19 names a destructive threesome. Verse 19 in Mark 4 names a destructive threesome. Number one, the cares of this world. The cares of this world can overtake us. Number two, the deceitfulness of riches. The deceitfulness of riches can sidetrack us. Number three, and the desires for other things that all that money could buy. Should I spend it all on this or that or the other thing or what? Wealth is deceitful because it can impart a false sense of security in people. When we add a certain amount of anxiety and desire, which is coveting, by the way, other words for coveting, when we add a certain amount of anxiety and desire to money's power, the three things together can keep a constant coveting on our mind to do something with that money. This can distract us from giving ourselves in true service to God at the feast. Yet for most of us, we have saved our second tithe faithfully. We have more than enough wealth available to us at the feast than at any other time of the year. God gives us the responsibility to control its use over a week or so. Have you ever noticed how Hollywood portrays the average religious person? Invariably, he is drab. He and she are drab in dress and dull in personality, timid, fumbling, and insecure. They rarely ever are shown in positions of leadership. The screenwriters and directors seem to operate on the theory that if a person has God in his life, they will have nothing else. Life will be boring. Life will be boring if you're a Christian. They depict it like this because our society's religions often project it that way. Perhaps a Christian's most persistent trial springs from this mindset about a Christian that we get from this world. All too often the real Christian has the same Hollywood attitudes in his mind because we all came out of this world and were influenced by it. This idea is entirely wrong. Entirely wrong. Was the Apostle Paul's life depressingly boring? I think most of the people in this world have read a lot from the Apostle Paul. Did he have a boring life? His writings ring with enthusiasm, zeal, and excitement. Has anyone ever had as many adventures in the performance of their job as Paul? I mean, it was one excitement, not always fun excitements, but, you know, pleasing. And Paul was the kind of person, too, that looked at trials as something God gave him for a purpose, either for him or for the people he was talking to and being an example to. Were Noah, Abraham, Moses, and David's lives dull? Those of you who have read that will laugh, too, because they were anything but dull. Were their relationships with God not the driving force in their lives? They certainly were. Were they not leaders? They certainly were. Were their lives filled to the brim and running over with adventure? Oh, an understatement. They were certainly not dull of personality. That's for sure. These guys were powerful. Turn to Philippians 3 and verse 8. Philippians 3 and verse 8. Our persistent day-to-day trial is to keep this world from deflecting us from God's wonderful purpose. That is something we need to be careful of. We need to be careful of to keep this world from deflecting us from God's wonderful purpose. That can happen so accidentally, it's not funny. These men of the Bible achieved that, but not without a struggle. Just like them, the world is in us. We carry it everywhere we go. Its concepts are in our mind. We cannot forget that. We should not forget that. We must deal with it and overcome it. Booths, the Feast of Tabernacles, and rejoicing have much to do with helping us to do just that, to fight this problem. It's a shot in the arm in a huge way if we have the right spiritual things on our mind as we go through having such an educational and wonderful time at the feast. Seek first the kingdom of God. Seek first the kingdom of God every day, and especially at the feast. Turn to Philippians 3 and verse 8. Philippians 3 and verse 8. Paul writes, while you're turning, I'm going to read a little bit else here. But Paul writes, "But indeed, I also count all things as loss for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, that I may gain Christ, that I may gain Christ. So says Philippians 3 and verse 8. Paul was committed. He did not seem to think his Christian life was boring or he would not have suffered the loss of all of his worldly wealth, of which he had lots. And he lost a lot more than just money. He was a well-known man in the Pharisees community, a well-known man who had enough influence to cause many Christians to be put to death. And he put all of it behind him, all the power, all the wealth, and all the money. Way more than anybody in this room has gotten or in our church has gotten. We have some people with serious money in this room, and Paul was at that level and higher. The only solution we have is to do what Paul did. Take up Jesus' challenge. We must truly seek God's kingdom first and let him add all these other things as he promised that he would. He just didn't say when he would give them all to us, but he will, and it's a guarantee because God's word is more than golden. I once heard a speaker say this: it takes 5% effort to win a person to Christ, 5% effort, and 95% to keep him in Christ and growing to maturity, 95% effort. There are two closely related reasons for this. Reason number one, the individual fails initially to count the cost that he truly understands the commitment to Christ. He has way underestimated. In fact, I went through it, maybe most of you in this room. When I first came into God's church, I had no idea what I was faced with. Changing my life and changing things in my life that were seriously a part of me. And as I went down through the years, I found more of these things and more of these things and more of these things. And it was not easy. Luke 14, verse 26 through 33 tells us that. Second thing, once committed, he fails to think about the events and attitudes of his life in relation to the kingdom of God. All of the things that It is part of the problem of when we go through the conversion process of making sure that every element of our life that we go through reconciles to God's purpose. It's hard to remember to do that all the time. It still is. I've been in the church for 46, 47 years, and I still find myself sometimes I'll do something and I'll shake my head and say, I should have never done that. Should have never done that. Without this, without these attitudes, a Christian never gets past the surface of the teachings of God's word. Unless you get serious about God's word and doing what God tells you, you never get past the surface of the teachings of God's word. You may have the words, but you don't have the principles behind those words. This situation results in a person with so many interests in life that they crowd out the most important one. Or conversely, a single interest other than seeking the kingdom of God consumes them. If a Christian fails to prioritize properly, he neglects the most important thing. That choice belongs to them, to him, and each and every one of us. Most of us fall into the first category where everything is the same size and of importance. We have no single great priority. Confusion results when things are poorly defined. Turn to Deuteronomy 14 and verse 22. Deuteronomy 14 and verse 22. A young woman was attending a lecture. While you're turning there, I got a comment or two. A young woman was attending a lecture on how to live on 24 hours a day. After the lecture, she told the man giving the lecture, "I'm going to concentrate," is what she said. "I'm going to concentrate." And the guy giving a lecture said, "On what?" And she said, "A lot of things," she replied. When we concentrate on many things, we actually concentrate on nothing. When you're overloaded with stuff, you actually concentrate on nothing, and it's hard to get a priority. And when that happens, we have to remember the God we worship, and he ought to come to the surface, especially when we're overloaded. Because of that reason, and also because, by the sounds of it, under those circumstances, we need his help to get through it all. Deuteronomy 14, verse 22, 23, and 26 clarifies a portion of the feast's purpose. Deuteronomy 14, hopefully you're there by now. If I gave you the verse when I was supposed to, you would be. I think I did. "You shall surely tithe all the increase of your grain that the field produces year by year. You shall eat before the Lord your God in a place where he chooses to make his name abide. The tithe of your grain and your new wine and your oil, of the firstborn of your herds and your flocks, that you may learn to fear the Lord your God always." Why do we tithe? Why? The answer is right there in that scripture. "That we may learn to fear the Lord your God always." Verse 26, skipping to verse 26. "And you shall spend the money on whatever your heart desires, for oxen or sheep." I've been going to God's feast for 46 or 47 years, and I haven't bought an ox or a sheep yet. I'm thinking about it, though. "For wine," no, I can't say that about the wine. "Wine or similar drink, or for whatever your heart desires. You shall eat there before the Lord your God, and you shall rejoice." Notice it does not say you may rejoice, or, you know, if you kind of think about it, it would be nice if you'd rejoice. What does he say? You shall rejoice. It's an order to rejoice. In all things at the feast, including, spending the money, playing musical instruments or singing, or if you get involved in athletic events or, you know, conversations or whatever it is, we should remember to rejoice. And the things that we say and do to the people that we're talking to and relating to should have to do with what? Rejoicing. When they get back home, and if they watch mainstream television media, they got enough things to feel bad about. They don't need you messing them up at the feast with bad news. We're to rejoice at the feast in every bit of it, you and your household. God commands us to keep the feast, number one, to enjoy the fruits of our labors and his blessings. Number two reason, to learn things. The emphasis on learning is why the feast is not a vacation. Though it is a pleasant interlude in our annual calendar, learning takes effort. Learning takes effort. And anybody who's ever done a significant amount of Bible study knows. It's interesting, it is. But it takes some work. It takes some work to get through what you need to go through sometimes to get to what God really means in a certain scripture. It takes work. It can be tiring. It can also be fulfilling and rewarding when you get done. It's nice to get done with God's word, knowing the importance of it, and that now for the first time I really understand what that message says, that what that scripture says. Accomplishment produces a sense of well-being, and studying God's word definitely does that. Learning to fear God always, and especially at the feast. We are to learn to fear God. This fear covers all the ground from anxious concern that plays around the edges of our mind. Through a deep, abiding, reverential respect of which we have a constant, comfortable awareness, to occasional sheer terror. Why would we have terror in learning? Why would we have terror? Well, because your eternal life is at stake. in many of these things that you're, most of the things that you study in Scripture. Your eternal life is at stake. And when you come to realize that, and you know that you're faltering a little bit or whatever, whatever, and you realize the consequences are your eternal life, should that cause some tear in you? Yeah. Yeah, it really should. Yeah, it really should. It also arises from knowledge of being in God's presence at the feast, whether we're behaving ourselves or not. If we've been called by God and we're not where we should be, we are still in God's presence, and we know that He is aware of us and everything that we're doing. Fear has the power either to attract us to God or repel us from Him. Moses was attracted when he saw the burning bush. Jacob was attracted when he dreamed of the ladder at Bethel. These men must have had a sense of what was happening within the context of God's purpose. Conveniently, because of their sin, fear drove Adam and Eve to what? To hide on God. They realized they had done something incredibly serious and that the penalty would be eternal death. And they hid from God. Of course, then they didn't die right away, and how they went through all that scenario and learned things as they lived, as I'm sure they did. Learning to fear God fits into the greater theme and purpose than just the Feast of Tabernacles. Perhaps we can understand the importance of learning to fear God through the feast by an illustration involving money. Deuteronomy 16, verse 6 commands all males to appear before God at his feasts. Deuteronomy 14, verse 22 tells us to tithe completely in full understanding to ensure that we have the money to attend the feast. Consider that this tithe should be equal to the first tithe. The second tithe is equal to the first tithe. Now, our former church organization, the Worldwide Church of God, whose figures I'm using here, reported that about 80% of its income came from its members. If the annual income was $160 million, then $128 million in tithes and offerings came from the members. If, say, $48 million of the $128 million was from offerings, then around $80 million came from members' tithes. That the amount of the festival tithe should have been equal to that amount, $80 million. Since we spent most of our second tithe at the Feast of Tabernacles, church members worldwide spent approximately $80 million in 2 weeks around the world. You wonder why people kissed the Worldwide Church of God, business people around the world trying to get us to come there. They knew they would make tons of money. $80 million in about 2 weeks while keeping the Feast of Tabernacles. These figures may not be exact, but they illustrate the importance of God's place, that the importance that God places on the Feast of Tabernacles. Consider the staggering amount of money God has set aside to help us rejoice and learn to fear Him at the same time. That's worth some taking a look at the money in your pocket that you have for the feast and the blessings that it's bringing to you. And the blessings that the rest of the money that you have earned throughout the course of the year has brought to you. If that's not worth a little thank you to God, I don't know what is. We are strangers and pilgrims. We are strangers and pilgrims in booths at the feast. Took me a long time before I really understood what's a booth? We all stay in hotels and fancy. What's this booth business? Took me a long time to get my act around that one. When in their history did Israel dwell in booths? Israel kept the feast in booths because their forefathers dwelt in them in the wilderness. Before God brought them into the promised land, Leviticus 23, verses 22 and 23, tells us that God brought them into the promised land. We can extract two related, valid spiritual lessons for us from this. To some, living in booths may seem a lack of amenities. I mean, living in booths, that's not living high in the hog. even back then, you're not living high, you're basically living in a tent or, in a brush shelter that you made to be a booth. But we do not associate such with rejoicing. We don't associate living in a booth or a tent with rejoicing. And those of you who will be going to where you're camping this year, I don't think many of you are living in tents, but you could be. And if you did, that wouldn't be a bad idea. It would help you to remember the importance of a booth, which we'll get to. Notice the wording in Leviticus 23 and verse 40. Leviticus 23 and verse 40 says this. We've already read it. So you don't have to necessarily read it again. Fruit of beautiful trees, branches of palm trees, the boughs of leafy trees, and willows of the brook. This implies not a ramshackle state, but the best and most beautiful shelter that the Israelites of that time could construct under those circumstances. Think of this in terms of hotels. We can hardly say a hotel is austere living. And we are certainly not in great poverty. Who's going to live in poverty at the feast? Raise your hand. All those hands. No, the first purpose of booths is to teach something else entirely. The purpose of a booth doesn't teach austerity. It teaches something else entirely. What is it? Temporariness. Temporariness is what it teaches. 1 Peter 2, verse 11 confirms that under the new covenant, we too should consider ourselves aliens and pilgrims in relation to this world that we live in. We are aliens and pilgrims, and we cut that before. We read that before in a previous scripture. We are aliens and pilgrims in relation to this world. We are now co-heirs of the earth with Christ. We are to live our lives as we are just passing through on the way to our inheritance. We are pilgrims. We are pilgrims just on our way through, living to our true home, our inheritance in the future, the kingdom of God. A pilgrim is a person who is out of their own country in a foreign land. A pilgrim does not intend to put down roots because they know they're not staying there, but is headed elsewhere towards a definite place and goal. Thus, his life is always in transition. And that's not a bad thing when you're a Christian. We are in transition in this world. To where? The kingdom of God, our real home. We should not view ourselves as permanently anchored to the society in which we now live. We should not be doing that because that's not who we should be. And that is the reason for booths. To bring that home to our mind. That is the reason you are living in a hotel temporarily. It is not your home. You're not going to stay there because that's not where you're going to end up spiritually. Hebrews 11, verse 13 through 16 firmly confirms this. Turn there, please. Hebrews 11, verse 13. Hebrews 11, verse 13. Please turn there. And I should have told you to turn there earlier, but I did. I skipped over that for some reason. Hebrews 11 and verse 13. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, were assured of those promises, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. You're not just strangers and pilgrims in the United States. You're strangers and pilgrims on the earth. For those who say such things declare plainly that they seek their homeland. That's who you are because you're seeking your homeland. And truly, if they had called to mind the country from which they had come out, the United States of America, for example, they would have had an opportunity to return. They could have gone back. They could have gone back according to the scripture. But now they desired a better, more heavenly country. They didn't want to go back. Once they saw what they had in God's kingdom, they did not want to go back. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. Was Abraham a pilgrim? God promised him Canaan as his home. The land of Canaan was to be his home. But as far as he was physically concerned, it wasn't his, you know, it belonged to somebody else. Abraham never owned Canaan, never owned it. As a matter of fact, Abraham never owned any land whatsoever, with one exception. Except for a small cave in which to bury his loved ones. Except for a small cave in which he was buried eventually, and where he buried his loved ones. That's the only real estate that man ever owned. So says, you'll find that in Genesis 23 in that chapter. He could not settle down and take roots within the community because of the life to which God had called him. Abraham, despite receiving great material prosperity from God, he was an incredibly rich man who actually had so many servants, he had his own army. When he went, if you remember, he went to rescue Lot. His nephew got taken away by bandits. And Lot was rich too, and they took him away, his wife away, and everything that he had. And Abraham took his army and went after them and got him back. Did Abraham have an army? Oh yeah, he sure did. But he lived a nomadic existence as the father of the faithful. Abraham never owned any property except for a cave to bury the dead in, and he never owned any other real estate in his life. Yet it's interesting to know that his destiny in prophecy from the Lord God was that the nations that came from Israel would be a great blessing to the entire world. So was because Abraham followed God, was his impact on this world in our age significant? You figure it out. And even nations that are not Israelite nations have been incredibly blessed because of the Israelite nations. Because of the Israelite nations. Did I tell you to turn to Isaiah 4 and verse 6? You might want to do that. James writes, pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this: to visit the orphans and widows in their trouble, and to keep oneself unspotted from the world. So says James 1 and verse 27. Since we are not literally wandering, this verse is a simple statement of faith's responsibility. We are to keep the world's system and ways at arm's length and not let it squeeze us into its mold by accident. So says Romans 12 and verse 2, demonstrating a simple and sincere devotion to God through compassionate relationships with others, especially those who have less than we do. God's divine care for his people, now, during the year, and also at the feast. God's divine care for his people. Isaiah 4 and verse 6, hopefully you're there. Another spiritual lesson of Booth's is that despite the Israelites' weak position while wandering in the wilderness, God supplied all of their needs in the wilderness. The Booth's are a memorial of God's grace, care, and protection on our pilgrimage. On our pilgrimage. God is there. As soon as you were conceived, God has watched every moment of your life, ever since, as a first fruit. Because you're a first fruit, is he concerned about you? Oh yeah. A stiff wind could flatten a booth, or at least blow the leaves away, exposing the interior to the elements and leaving the inhabitants at their mercy. Even as a booth appeared to be a symbol of austerity and fragileness, they also seem to be a symbol of weakness and vulnerability. However, the opposite is true. Why? Because of what God did to protect those people. Even though they paid no attention to him and turned their back on him at every turn, God did not, in the wilderness, he did not abandon him. And no horrible thing affected them, even though they're living in a pile of brush, which they called a booth. Turn to Isaiah 4 and verse 6. Isaiah 4 and verse 6. And there will be a tabernacle or booth for shade in the daytime and from the heat, for a place of refuge and for shelter from storms and rain. So says Isaiah 4 and verse 6. The context is a prophecy that shows Zion becoming a place of refuge, a secure threat in time of trouble. A booth's use depends upon the situation. The booth's use depends upon the situation. In the wilderness, the booth provided adequate shelter because God was always overseeing the protection and care of his people. Now, when we're in a hotel room, the situation is a little bit different. But throughout our lives, we also find ourselves in critical needs because of various circumstances that we face. The booth thus symbolizes the fullness of God's divine protection and care of his people, including you. Turn to Deuteronomy 8 and verse 2. Deuteronomy 8 and verse 2. Deuteronomy 8 reveals to us the meaning of what we experience as a pilgrim. Deuteronomy 8 and verse 2. And you shall remember that the Lord your God led you all the way these 40 years in the wilderness to humble you and to test you. Why did God lead them in the wilderness for 40 years? To humble and to test you, to know what was in your heart. Why is God sending you to the feast with a ton of money in your pocket? Because he wants to know your heart, whether you would keep the commandments or not. So he humbled you, allowed you to hunger. He fed you with manna, which you did not know, and neither did your fathers know, that it might make you know that man shall not live by bread alone, but man shall live by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Through trials, God seeks to help us to see our need and dependence upon him. We must learn that life, both physical and spiritual, depends on what God supplies. It does. Everything that you buy in the grocery store is supplied by God. Everything that your house is built out of is supplied by God. All the money in your plastic credit card or cash in your pocket, the paper and the plastic was supplied by God. The gold and the silver was supplied by... There's nothing that you have that was not supplied by God. We must learn that life, both physical and spiritual, depends upon what God supplies. Our reaction to trials reveals what is in our heart. Our reaction to trial reveals what is in our heart. That is what really motivates us. He puts us into distress to make us realize our needs and to depend on him to help us with those needs. He wants to see whether we will live by faith, depend on him to supply those needs or not. He needs to see whether we will keep his commands even when disobeying them appears that if we disobeyed God, we would solve this huge, great, big problem that we're facing. When you follow God, even when you're faced with those difficult trials, why did you face that trial? As a first fruit, you can be guaranteed you face that trial because God wants to know exactly where you're at today. And I've been in the church for 46 or 47 years, and I know I will face more trials. And if you don't think that going through the death, your death, and the death of the loved ones around you won't be a trial, I got news for you. You're going to face... The age I am, I've been in the church for 46 years, and the one thing I know for sure, I have not faced my last trial. Things happen to those of faith so that they might possess qualities of mind, character, and heart that would otherwise not be available to them. We can take these qualities through to the grave and as far as even into the kingdom of God. So says Jesus in John 15 and verse 5. Without me, you can do nothing, says God. The fruits of God's Spirit can be produced through faith only in cooperation with God in his purpose as we proceed on our pilgrimage. Learning discipline, for all of the year and especially at the feast. Learning discipline at the feast. At the feast, God commands us to show him at least a small part of what is in our hearts. God wants us to go to services every day to confront him personally. Every day. What is the difference? What is the difference between the high day of the feast and the eighth day and the rest of the days during the feast? Well, for one thing, I know that all of you are at least a little bit converted. Because if you had a choice to go on both high days where you had to give money, those are the days you'd skip. And you go to the other days. So I know when you hit only the high days, I know that there's a certain amount of spiritual business going on there. But every day, what's the difference between a high day and the other days of the feast? Well, first of all, on the high days, we're not to work, right? I wouldn't do anything that would take my mind. I wouldn't work, and I wouldn't do anything that would take my mind off God in some way. I wouldn't play a serious game of ping pong. I wouldn't play a serious game of golf. I would not play a serious game of baseball, basketball, or football. I wouldn't play bridge. Bridge takes a tremendous amount of and those are just examples. I wouldn't do those days on the holy days. Would I do those during the week? Yeah. Yeah. But remember where we talked about the 7 days of the feast being a meeting, a conference? Yeah. Where you go to learn more about God. We're supposed to do that. We're supposed to do that. We are to keep the feast of the Lord for 7 days, not just one. Leviticus 23, verse 41 tells us that. Not just on the holy day. He wants to see our reaction to that. God occasionally provides even a measure of hardship at the feast for us, but he does not give it in wrath. He is trying to teach us discipline. He wants us to consider if we have forgotten him or put him in a secondary position at the feast. With all that money in your pocket, everybody, including me, has carnal impulses to do things on those days that are not the high days. And I haven't spent much time with God yet, and I need to rethink my program. Sometimes because I just forgot to involve God. In other cases, I've been so busy on those days doing other activities, I've been focusing on that instead of involving God in my life. Has God not supplied our needs to enable us to be at the feast? The reason we're at the feast is because of the needs that God has supplied to us. He has given us not just the money, but all the experiences of the past year that helped to shape us into what we are now. Are you the same person that you were a year ago? Spiritually. That's something to thank God about. Because he has been involved in your life. Has God not been involved in our lives in some way over this past year? Absolutely. I'm sure he has, in mine and in yours as well. What do we emphasize at the feast? The daily meetings with God at services and in prayer? Or the sightseeing, shopping, entertainment, and other distractions from the spiritual purpose of the feast? And they don't have to be the distractions. That's the point. They should not. These other things should not be distractions. When you're having a real blessing, a real physical blessing at the feast, a real good time interacting with other people, having a real good time playing cards at the feast with somebody or whatever, just take a minute and say, Eleanor and I used to play cards all the time. Now we hardly ever play cards. We had nobody to play cards with. Do I enjoy playing cards these days? I want to play some cards at the feast. And I need to remember while I'm playing cards to thank God for the opportunity to do this silly little thing. These activities are not evil, but we must learn to prioritize and discipline ourselves and emphasize the spiritual. James writes, turn to Isaiah 4 and verse 6. James writes, pure and undefiled religion before God the Father is this, to visit the orphans and widows in their trouble and to keep oneself unspotted from the world. So says James 1 and verse 27. Since we are not literally wandering, this verse is a simple statement of faith's responsibility. We are to keep this world, we are to keep this world's system and its ways at arm's length by not letting us be influenced by those things. By letting us be influenced by those things. Through trials, God seeks to help us see our need and dependence upon Him. We must learn that life, both physical and spiritually, depends on what God supplies. Our reaction to trials reveals what is in our heart and what really motivates us. With prosperity comes an ever-present danger of pride that begets forgetfulness. This form of pride is especially insidious because without realizing it, pride moves us to the self. Pride tends to move us to focus on ourselves. It makes us pay an inordinate amount of attention to number one, to us. So God gives us prosperity at the feast to see how we will handle it. We have to learn what is real and true. Reality lies in the realm of spiritual faith, where are we actually looking for real truth? Where are we actually looking for real truth? What is the goal in our lives? The physical? The physical is real, but it is limited. It is limited, deceptive, and vain. The spiritual is eternal and truly satisfying. Psalm 78 gives a clear and concise history of Israel's relationship with God. The psalmist illustrates four things that led to their rebellion, that led to Israel's rebellion. Number one thing, they forgot God's goodness. They forgot God's goodness and all He had given him in involving God in appreciation for that goodness. Number two, they tested God by insisting that He satisfy their lusts. So says Psalm 78, 18, verse 18 and 19. Number three, they played moral hide-and-seek with God, which is a hypocrisy. They served Him only when they discovered for the moment that they could not escape Him. Psalm 78, verses 35 and 37. Finally, they substituted idols for their God, as the center of their lives, verses 57 and 58. Israel never got the true picture because they were walking by sight and not by faith. That's a real danger. They were so impressed by what they saw that they limited God's ability to create in His heart and in His mind. Create Him in His heart and in His mind. We are supposed to be putting the mind of Christ inside of us. And we can get so tangled up on other things that just doesn't rise to the top and become a priority when it is critical to our salvation. Grasping reality. God is concerned about the inner man. God is concerned about the inner man. That is the part of us by which we can recognize and grasp spiritual realities. By it, we make the choices that will lead to fulfilling God's purpose for us. It is this part of us that walks by faith. God will exceedingly abundantly provide for us within the context of His purpose. So says Ephesians 3 and verse 20. Even as God did for Israel in the wilderness, they appeared so vulnerable, Israel in the wilderness looked so vulnerable, weak, and exposed while living in the open booths. But they had everything they needed. He promised to provide for all our needs also. He promised to provide for all our needs also, according to the riches of the glory by Jesus Christ. So says Philippians 4 and verse 19. We often expound on 2 Corinthians 13:5 during the spring festival season, but it always applies. It always applies. Examine yourself. Now is a good time before you go to the feast. Examine yourselves as to whether you are in the faith. Prove yourselves. Here Paul uses faith as a sense of truth. Those who are in the truth live by faith. They live according to their belief in God. The truth is the center of their lives, and by it, they direct and choose the course of their lives. The Feast of Tabernacles involves learning if we are living by faith or sight. It exposes whether we are led by God's Spirit or by carnality. It reveals whether we can separate human vanity from spiritual reality. God is very concerned not only with what we do, but why we do it. This makes fearing God vitally important. Doing everything in relation to Him and His purpose converts ordinary mundane acts to ones of spiritual significance, a principle we need to apply especially at the feast. If we have a deep and abiding respect for God and His Word, arising from an awareness that He personally is a part of our lives, has great awe-inspiring plans for us, we then have a powerful motivation to make choices based upon faith in our God. We can easily make the acceptance of Christian faith a substitute for living it. We can easily make an acceptance for Christian faith a substitute for living it. Jesus says, "But why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say?" So says Luke 6:46. Each person must do his own examination. One may hear a sermon that affects him, that shows him where he is wrong. But true conviction of wrong is not reached until one sees his sin and condemns themselves. The fear of God is working in us. The fear of God should be working in us in that way. In 2 Corinthians 13, verse 11, Paul admonishes us to strive for spiritual completion. He urges a positive, steady advance in right living attitudes. The Feast of Tabernacles is a means that God has created to help us be prepared and spiritually completed for His kingdom. Turn to Ephesians 3 and verse 14. Ephesians 3 and verse 14. Dwelling in feasts, dwelling at the feast in booths, which is what we should be thinking when we checked into our room. Dwelling temporarily at the feast, our booths should be constantly reminding us to reflect on our temporary transitional role as pilgrims and ambassadors in this physical world. As a true pilgrim, we should recognize that God has been supplying all of our needs, or we would not be at the feast. As pilgrims in temporary dwellings, this feast should also remind us that truly our permanent roots do not lie in this world, not just in your house, not just in the United States. They don't lie in this world at all. We should be focusing on the real and true facts. These real and true facts at the Feast of Tabernacles. God's kingdom, our real permanent eternal residence, should be very real to us. Anyone who is seriously traveling to a destination, when you want to go someplace and you don't know where you're going, what do? To make sure you get to the exact right place, you put that address and your GPS system in your car, don't you? Isn't that what you do? Has that GPS system accurate? Have you set your GPS system accurately to the address of your home kingdom, the kingdom of God? That is where your spiritual GPS system ought to be set. In Ephesians 3, verses 14 through 21, the Apostle Paul has very accurately captured the spiritual purpose for Jesus' disciples. Let's review it. Please do turn there. Ephesians 3 and verse 4, in verse 14. Ephesians 3 and verse 14. For this reason I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, that's written in the scripture, you, speaking to you and me personally, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might through his spirit, where? In the inner man, inside of the very most inner part of your very mind. Verse 17, that Christ may dwell in your heart through faith, through your faith, that you, again we have you, this is addressed to you personally, that you being rooted and grounded, how? In love, being rooted and grounded in love, that you, verse 18, may be able to comprehend with all the saints the width and length and depth and height of what? Verse 17, the love of Jesus Christ in you. How big is the love of Jesus Christ in you? Big enough that it has width, depth, length, and height. Do you think God takes you seriously? Something that we should all keep our mind on. Verse 19, to know the love of Christ which passes human knowledge. The love that Jesus Christ has for you literally passes the human mind's capability of even beginning to comprehend the width, depth, and of it. That you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Verse 20. Now to him. That him refers to the Father. And just how do we know that him refers to the Father? Father, let's read on. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think. We can't even ask for things big enough to comprehend what God is capable of giving us and will give to us in his kingdom. Our human minds are so limited. According to the spiritual power that works in us. Verse 21. Here we're back to him again. Listen to this. To him be the glory in the church by Jesus Christ. The him cannot be Jesus Christ. The him refers to the Father. To him be the glory in the church by Jesus Christ. Because of verse 21, clearly we know that the Father is the him referred to here. Verse 21, let's read it again without me adding stuff. To him be the glory in the church, to Jesus Christ, to all generations forever and ever. Amen. God is working to share the riches of his glory with his entire family. God's primary purpose is to prepare his people for living in Jesus' inheritance as well as our own inheritance. Because if you remember, he inherits the kingdom and so do we. To this end, Paul prays that we might use our spiritual privileges to the full and receive the strength of the Father's Holy Spirit to the full in the very innermost part of our being, inside of the center of our heart, the center of our mind. Paul asks that Jesus may dwell in our hearts through our faith and that each one of us will be rooted and grounded in spiritual love, just like the Father, just like Jesus Christ and the Father. Keep the feast and rejoice this year, but do it with a spiritual purpose. Examine yourself and apply yourself at this feast. Focus on generating a loving and a spiritually healthy fear of God. Your eternal life depends on it. I'm glad I had this day because I could not have done this sermon at any other church service.